So ideally you're saving as hard as you can to put together your first deposit. Now, you've done everything you need to try and do this as fast as possible, but I guess the big question is, well, how much do you need? Well, look, really that's going to depend on the property cost. Normally you've got to allocate about 5% for costs, so that's stamp duty and legals, and that does change from state to state, so it can be kind of 4 to 6%. Plus generally you'll need about 5 to 20% deposit. So the banks aren't going to lend you 100%. Sometimes with a low deposit like 5%, they want to see genuine savings. So you can't put a lump sum in. You've got to show that you've saved it over a period of time because you're going to have a mortgage to pay in the future. And if it's something like 20%, then maybe it can be a handout from a parent or something. Now, a good idea is obviously to try and save a few percent more than the minimum deposit to cover expenses and contingencies. So you could suddenly get an extra legal bill, or maybe you don't get to buy the first property and you've got to check out quite a few. And so there's more inspection reports, there's maybe a few more legal fees and stuff like that. Now, another thing that people like to do is they want to start looking straight away. But I think you really need to try and get your finances in order to start with, because how can you start looking for properties if you don't even know how much money you can afford? And we haven't even covered the various different suburbs and the pros and cons of houses and units and new and old and all that kind of stuff. So looking for properties is pretty much fairly far down the track. But look, maybe if you're 3 to 6 months away from buying because you've saved your deposits and everything's getting into plan, then you can go and do that. Because in a perfect world, you need to look at about 50 to 100 properties if you're going to go off and do this yourself. So there may be 5 to 10 properties that you can see every Saturday, or maybe you can go out during the week. And so if you've got to see those 100 properties, then it could be kind of 10 to 20 weeks to try and get around that. Now, you're also going to need to try and find some extra cash to plan for maybe if the economy changes. The biggest thing is interest rates. The chances are they're going to rise, and it could be a lot more money. So for every $1 million, a 1% increase in interest rates, it's roughly about $10,000. So that's a lot of extra money that you're going to have to try and come up with. So an extra few hundred dollars a week. Then strata levy. So if you're buying a unit or a townhouse and there's some common property, i.e. some property that everyone uses, then everyone jointly has to put money in to manage all of that, and that costs. And so quite often on a unit, it could be $500, $1,000, or on expensive properties with lots of concierge, gardens, pools, things like that, then it could be $2,000 or $3,000 a quarter. So certainly a lot of money. Also, when you buy a property and you're looking at renting it out as an investment, you're not necessarily going to get a tenant straight away. If you've bought in a seaside town in the middle of winter, it could potentially take 4 or 8 weeks to go and find something. Maybe you need to do some renovations on the property, and that's going to delay being able to rent it out. So you've got to think all of these things so that you've got some spare money, so you don't buy the property and then you kind of go bust straight away. Also, you've got to think is, what if circumstances change? Now, you never want to think about the negative all the time. You need to try and be positive. But what if the day after you signed for your property, your partner decided that you wanted to get divorced, or you got made redundant at work, or suddenly you tripped over and there's a medical issue, or cancer, or heart attack, or stroke? Again, no one thinks these things are going to happen to them, but they do. So we'll go through some insurance stuff around that as well. But look, you really need to make sure that you can afford to service the mortgage moving forward. It's not just about getting the property straight away. It's sorting out the serviceability. So obviously you need to speak to the banks and the mortgage brokers to see what calculations they're going to take into account. And look, there's a possibility that you maybe be able to use your parents' home equity, either as a guarantee or an equity release, to help you get into that market, or maybe you can get a better property by using that as well. So definitely that's going to be a conversation to have with them. Now, you always need a bit of working capital. This is your buffer zone. This is to counter for the emergencies. Some of it's going to be in a lump sum, and then I guess some of the lump sum is going to help you to be able to cash flow the difference between the rent and the mortgage. And for most people that aren't putting down a massive deposit, there will be a difference between the rent and the mortgage. So you need to work out your rough maths on deposits, rents, interest rates, and growth to see what's going to happen. And as you'll find out in the workbook, there's a whole bunch of examples in there, and you can build your own things on Excel just to work out some different scenarios as things chop and change. So what you really want to do is create a bit of a checklist to see what bank accounts you've got, what balances are in there, what superannuation money you've got. You may or may not be able to use that. If you've got any other loans like car loans or personal loans, obviously your credit cards as well, Think about maybe any student debts that you've still got. And then when you go to a bank or a broker, they'll also want to see what your weekly expenses are. So let's just see how much money you spend on insurance, your food, your entertaining, your travel, your mobile phones, your coffees, all of those kind of things. Also then think about other loans that you might have and anything else financial that you've got in your paperwork. And I think I've mentioned it before, but if all of your documents, anything to do with finances, you start having a nice, easy filing system, an A4 lever arch file, rather than having an absolute headache of trying to find this stuff, just start becoming more organized. As you get your bank statements in, have a look at them, double check them, put them in the filing system rather than in the drawer and having to spend days and days trying to file things afterwards. It makes life so much easier. And when you go to a bank or a broker, you can just take that whole lever arch file down there or just get them to go and photocopy it. So again, none of this has to be really hard stuff. Get organized and life is a lot more simple.